Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Cinema Savvy. I'm your host, George Aldridge, and tonight the Infinity Saga Retrospective continues as we reach the first introduction to the Guardians of the Galaxy. Of course, Guardians of the Galaxy, directed by James Gunn. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the channel. Of course, we are talking Guardians of the Galaxy tonight. I'm your host, George. Joining me, as usual, we have Chris. I'm going to point these right, I think. Chris, Tayte, and returning Theo for another Infinity Saga, introduction, discussion, because we're almost halfway through. We're on film number 10 now, and I don't know if it's a bit of a weird one for you guys jumping in. There's no one new, so I have to quiz you all on who is your favourite Avenger. I'm not going to do any of that. But what I actually am going to ask, without sort of getting into it yet, because I'm sure we're going to go into it, each of you let me know your favourite Guardian of the Galaxy, because I think that's a worthy question to ask straight away. Chris?
Oh, God. Probably Rocket. The guy just cracks me up, just from a visual standpoint, but just his attitude and everything. He's also got quite a lot of tragedy to him as well, which I'm sure we'll discuss later, but he always gets a laugh out of me. So probably Rocket Raccoon.
I am quite a big fan of Gamora. I think her story over the entire Infinity saga is one of the most intriguing. And yeah, this film was a really good introduction to that.
Mine's Nebula, I think, because I just think Nebula's story as well. If you move on throughout, like, as we move to Infinity War and we move to Endgame, I think Karen Gillan's portrayal is what almost gave Nebula a bigger part in those stories as well, because she is so good.
No, definitely. That's a lovely little start. Mine's Drax. I almost said Batista then. The reason is, of course, Batista. But nice. We've got four different picks between us. It's not as single-handedly sort of one way as this is with the Captain America ranking. Here we are in the Infinity Saga. And he has an Infinity Gauntlet. The rest of them have one stone each. And Thanos looks absolutely pathetic right now next to Hawkeye and Spider-Man. I'm not going to lie. Someone needs to get his score up. We'll find a Thanos fan somewhere else. However, we aren't here to talk about the Avengers just yet. This is the other team, the guys that have obviously a massive thing in the Avengers. So, for everybody watching at home, we want you to comment along with us tonight. Let us know your thoughts on the Guardians of the Galaxy. Not even the first film, that think of them as individuals, them as a team. James Gunn's writing so much stuff we're going to cover tonight. It's almost like a reset, because I've got a feeling this is the first time we've spoken about this film on the channel. I know we obviously did a review on the second one, but so many years have passed. 2014 is a long time ago, and I can still remember everything about this. However, before I get into everyone's first time watching this, hit us up on our social medias, which is Facebook at Cinema Savvy, Twitter at Cinema_Savvy, Letterboxd.com/CinemaSavvy, and we have a link to T Public in the description below. Now, back to where we were. I'm going to ask Chris again once more. You're at the lead. Can you remember the first time you saw this or any hype leading into it? Because this was obviously a massive one for Marvel. This was, quote, the biggest risk yet, which we have to keep saying every few films now. But certainly 2014 was, I think, the one that sort of cemented Marvel Studios as they will make money on anything.
So I don't so much remember the actual event of seeing the movie. It was more the lead up and sort of like the confusion. And we'll talk about this in terms of it like being the greatest risk, but every Marvel film that came out before this one was a character that I may not have known everything about them, but I was aware of the character. Iron Man, Thor, Hulk, Captain America. There were characters that I knew. And even moving into phase two as well, you know, we kind of had that repetition. We had like Iron Man 3, you know, again, a familiar character at that point, Thor, another Captain America film, and then boom, Guardians of the Galaxy. And I was like, okay, what's Guardians of the Galaxy? And then you start, you know, going onto Wikipedia and you see this lineup of these characters where there's a tree person and a raccoon with a gun. And you're like, what the hell is this? This is so random. It felt like almost like a combo breaker in terms of all the other ones. And yeah, I mean, it was everything. It was the film that everything was riding on. It's such a completely outlandish concept. You know, you start getting cosmic with it. Like, I guess you could say that Thor dabbled with that a little bit in terms of Asgard and this mythology, but this is space, and this is just go as nuts as you want in space. So I remember being really confused about it and go like, this could go either way. But you know, the trailers came out, you had the music. We'll definitely be talking about the music later on. So I was kind of on board from that, and just because I like space films, and I like ensemble films as well, where you have a party of, you know, colorful and different characters that all have to come together. So I was kind of won over by the trailers. And then, the first time seeing it, it was a really fun space adventure romp film with a great cast of characters. And that was sort of my takeaway from it. But I remember more the confusion and in the lead up to actually seeing the film.
I think I'm on exactly the same page as you there. I remember the complete and utter confusion, going to message boards online and trying to find out as much information as possible on the film, trying to figure out how it actually fit into the MCU, trying to make the links of kind of what story they would be possibly going with. I know we've been doing that recently with a lot of kind of the Marvel things, but this was one of the first ones where I suddenly went, oh, I maybe need to do a bit of research on this film. I maybe need to kind of think about it and look at kind of some of the stuff and get some context going into it. I remember the first trailer coming out and immediately being sold on it. It just looked like a very fun space adventure film. And I thought, wow, they're really expanding the Marvel universe into space. And they're really kind of adding in this extra kind of stuff to go with it. So I was immediately on board. And when the film came out, it was fantastic. I absolutely loved it. Instantly quotable and just instantly memorable within the Marvel catalog.
Yeah, mine's quite a lot different, to be honest. This predates sort of me even being a massive fan of the MCU, really. I remember I was in Austria for Christmas in 2014 or whenever it was. My mum had sent me some presents, and one of them happened to be the DVD of Guardians of the Galaxy, which I had no idea what it was. I knew it was a Marvel film. I'd never seen it. We put it on the coach on the way back, so I watched it on a screen no bigger than a laptop screen or an iPad screen, really. And I just remember like sort of falling in love with the characters and thinking that this is such a sort of outlandish concept. Like, I'd seen The Incredible Hulk and I'd seen the first Captain America and the first Iron Man up to that point. But nothing had really sort of, you know, engaged me to a point where like you guys, where I'd go and research it or go and be like, oh, what's next or what's coming after? And that sort of, Guardians was sort of the catalyst for me to go back and sort of, you know, from the beginning and watch up to that point and sort of delve into the sort of world of Thanos being introduced as a villain, really. It was quite a strange one.
Yeah, I think that's great, this, because Guardians is one of those films where I think it's so unique and it was so different that in the build-up to that, I think it's one that a lot of people can remember for so many different reasons. And I think I was in the second year at college at the time and I'd started watching Parks and Rec. So I remember seeing a trailer for a new Marvel film and was like, the hell, Andy Dwyer's got thin. Not me fat shaming at all. That was massive for people that had seen Parks and Rec. Like, this has just happened like this. Like, but I'm in. I'm sold. It's Marvel. It's got Sonya from Parks and Rec. And then you got Batista. And the wrestling fan in me from the years before was like, oh my God, it's Batista. He's not good. And we're wondering, is he going to Batista bomb anyone? And I remember there was so much curiosity in this. Even Karen Gillan popping up. I saw some of her doctor and I was like, wait, she's bold? I remember, but it was a bit like Natalie Portman. I don't know if anyone can remember when they were younger, before you even knew what V for Vendetta was. I remember seeing in the newspaper that Natalie Portman was bold, like, the hell? And it was kind of like that with Karen Gillan. And I remember going to the cinema and seeing this, I was with my friends, and I was blown away. I didn't know what to expect. I thought this is either going to be insanely awful or incredible, or it could be average, but I'm excited to see what happens because there was so much build-up, I think. As the months got closer, I think there was more like excitement building. And I ended up seeing this, I think, three times in the first week. It came on A-level results week as well, so I needed to get that out of my system straight away. So I went straight to the cinema. But this is the thing of Guardians. Like, it's amazing looking at it now, because we say, again, what, this was a risk at the time, and here we are in 2021, and it's there. Like, it's just another, not even team-up film. This is an origin film. Yeah, it is a team-up film of the team coming together and having a threat and slowly being introduced into the MCU. And it's amazing to think how on earth this works. And I think what's also a really big talking point for me was after the Winter Soldier came out. Now, I loved Winter Soldier on the first view. I knew it was one of the best. I wanted Ultron. I was like, who the hell are these guys? Why is Age of Ultron coming out next year? Why are we getting these? These aren't going to be an Age of Ultron. And again, obviously time helps everything, but that gap of getting another year to Age of Ultron, having something new, completely different before Ultron, help take your mind off things, and it just changed everything in terms of the cosmic stuff, building up to films in the future. And I think none of this is possible without James Gunn, who I think we need to speak about first. He is without a doubt the reason this film, I don't even want to say works. He basically is Guardians of the Galaxy to the point they had to bring him in on Infinity War to write some of the dialogue for these characters. He's so intrinsically linked with that group that no one was going to dare take Guardians 3 when that drama happened with Disney. And they had to bring him back because they know no one else, in theory, can rightfully do a Guardians film. And I just wanted to pass over, because we've all spoke a bit before we hit record, that I wasn't familiar with pretty much anything before this. You eventually discovered that he was the guy that wrote Scooby-Doo. I heard of a few of his films, and I had seen Super, but I had no idea what I was expecting. I think it's the same with you, Chris.
Yeah, so, I mean, I know a lot of the stuff he's worked on now in hindsight after this film, but when I first went to see this, I didn't know who James Gunn was. I didn't know who that guy was. And then, you know, you do a couple of Wikipedia searches later and you go, oh, it's the guy who wrote that horrible Kick-Ass knockoff called Super. I wasn't a fan of Super, I'm going to be honest. The Scooby-Doo films, like, if we were reviewing them now, we probably wouldn't say they're inherently good films, but they're nostalgic to us, so they will always be good films to us. So I've always had that attachment to those films in particular, but I didn't know that information before seeing this film. Now he is kind of like a household name, and not only did he go on and obviously do Guardians of the Galaxy 2, but he's been nabbed by another studio now to do another sort of group ensemble superhero film, which is going to be The Suicide Squad. And I'm sure once you see his kind of humor and how, you know, he can write characters and he knows sort of personalities within and personality traits and tropes with those characters within that group, I think that's going to translate well to other properties as well. I think he's kind of, he's found his niche now. I think he's found his strength with his writing, and it's the humor as well. The humor is so totally different as well from what we have seen from a lot of Marvel films before this point as well. I'd say in terms of some of the humor, it's also more near the mark perhaps than a lot of other Marvel films before this point. Not to the point where it gets, you know, really crass or anything like that, but it's a very different kind of humor to it, which I think a lot of people you know, gravitated towards. The film itself made just over 750 mil, and although it did set up a lot for the greater MCU to come, you know, we'll go into it later, but, you know, Thanos, Infinity Stones, and just the whole cosmic space side of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it still functions very much as a standalone Marvel film, at least before you get into, like, Guardians 2, like this one, the first Guardians of the Galaxy film. You can just view in isolation. It works, you know, on its own merits as a standalone space adventure film. And then, like, obviously your Marvel diehards are going to know where everything's going to lead to in Infinity Stones and all of that stuff. So I think it was the characters, and I think it was that humor that brought people back again and again. George, yourself saying you went to see this 3 times opening week. I think it's down to that writing and the humor and the characters that everyone just fell in love with.
I was going to say, it was a very ambitious film, and they had to have some kind of director who had some form with comedy or something like that. Because I would consider this to be a comedy action kind of superhero film, with comedy almost being one of the key components of that. We've had humor thrown in as like one-liners throughout various different other Marvel films, but this was the first film that actually made me laugh out loud on multiple occasions from the Marvel catalog, which was crazy to think like it would come from the film where they first go to space. But bringing in James Gunn, I mean, we talked a little bit about Scooby-Doo there. We had a brilliant time doing the drink along for that on the channel. But with those films, that humor, it's not quite adult humor. It's not quite childish humor. It's somewhere in between, and it works so well. And I think he brought those kind of elements into some of the characters in the film. The chemistry as well within the team works perfectly. I don't think the humor would have worked if they didn't have that kind of camaraderie and community between them. As actors and as characters within the film itself. But I think the writing absolutely helped with that. If you've got a good script and you've got good actors who can work with the material, then of course you can have a brilliant end product, and it just so happened to all come together with this film.
Yeah, I completely agree with what you guys have said. I think it's such a departure from what we've seen before, and I think, like, everyone's saying now, like, Doctor Strange 2 is going to be Marvel's first horror film, and I think this was Marvel's first comedy. I think other than, like, you have your dramatic elements and you have your MacGuffins that are in there to push the universe forward, but this really is an out-and-out comedy. The stuff between Rocket and Groot, and especially, like, even Gamora and Star-Lord, especially the bit where they're on that balcony and, you know, she talks about pelvic sorcery and stuff like that. That's just, well, what we know now is just out-and-out James Gunn, isn't it? But it, when you're watching that for the first time, you don't know who James Gunn is. It's just like it just has sort of a wave of, like, freshness, I think, which the MCU maybe needed at that point. We'd seen a lot of We've seen a lot of drama. We've seen a lot of action. We've seen a lot of films that are good films, but we've seen a lot of films that were going down the same path as far as their heroes were concerned. So to have something that sort of blew the entire, you know, universe and the audience's sort of minds wider open was needed, I think. And they just happened. Kevin Feige just hit the nail on the head with James Gunn, didn't he?
Yeah, I think as well, James Gunn, I mean, he said this last year, obviously, when he was in Suicide Squad, but he said that he read every single comic book ever written for Suicide Squad last year, before he even started writing. I would imagine that he did the same for Guardians of the Galaxy, that he probably took on this job thinking, okay, there's this film I want to make, or I'm in talks with Marvel for a new project. And you can imagine that guy, because he clearly loves the source material, and as a kind of compliment with the film, with direction, it even feels like a comic book that... It kind of jumps out, like the imagery, the writing, some of it's really short and snappy. You don't need sort of these insane monologues to get the plot moving. Everything's these character moments that come together, because within that he's written these, I don't want to say complex, but they're not uncomplex characters that, Chris, you kind of touched on earlier. Every single character has a personality. There's no two guardians that are carbon copies of one another. And that's always an issue with ensemble films, is that you can always have three or four people who could be anyone. It could have been anyone and anyone to that film and had any role, or that role could have been one. Everyone is such an integral part of this. And kind of moving into talking about the heroes as well, I think the reason why this film also works is not just because it's funny, but the thing with, I always hit the first Star Wars as an example for this. You have your main trio. How do they meet? They meet out of necessity, not the fact that there's a plot that needs to move on. That's common sense for every film ever made. But they have to meet. Han Solo is needed to be a pilot. Princess Leia is needed to be saved. There's a necessity for those characters to come together. And what I loved in this one is that they have a necessity, but it comes together out of nonsense. And that is the beautiful compliment. When they're running around and they all get arrested like absolute idiots, but that's how they meet. Because Star-Lord's been an idiot. Gamora's not worked. You've got Groot and Rocket. Everyone's set up so well for it to really kickstart in the prison cell. And I think the way he wrote building up to the escape, developing their bond across the film, I don't think that's the kind of writing that many people could do that have worked on the Marvel films, because taking that group into consideration is so much harder than, let's say, not to, I mean, we love Captain America, but you know you've got a core film about this one individual character, and yet these guys have got to accommodate everyone, which includes, not to put it lightly, a talking tree and raccoon. That is not something that's the kind of boring joke now that, they made a tree and raccoon talk. Because, like, yeah, they did. How many other people could ever do something like that? Not many at all.
The only one I can think of is in Lord of the Rings, and that's a completely different character. But anyway, that doesn't have a raccoon, at least. But, yeah, and I think the grouping works. I like the Star Wars comparison, because I've even seen people say this is sort of, that's like the next Star Wars, but in terms of that ensemble, you know, set in space, it's probably like an easy comparison for a lot of people. I love that at the beginning, and this just shows like the strength of, I guess it kind of goes into the sequel as well. There's no love lost between any of these characters. Each and every one of these characters is kind of in it with their own agenda. I guess the only sort of pairing that you've got out of the main lineup, I would say, is Groot and Rocket, but even they kind of have their own dynamic. And you know, I always compare Groot to like a lovable, slightly dumb Labrador. He's like a dog that's just going to go off and do his own thing, and Rocket's always got to be there to look after him. Like, he loves him, but it's, you know, it adds that really fun dynamic to him. But every other character, you know, you've got Drax there, who's just solely out for revenge, you know, to avenge his wife and daughter. You've got Gamora, who's the daughter of Thanos. You know, she's been tasked to do this thing. Every character has their own agenda, but the happenstance and out of necessity, as you said, brings them all together and they have to make it work. And it's very difficult, I think, to get an ensemble film right, and like everything has to be aligned and all the characters have to make sense, and things that the characters do have to make sense as well, pertaining to their own characterization and their own story arc that they've got going on. And I don't think anything more perfectly encapsulates that than the prison escape moment, where they all, I think that's probably the first moment where they do all have to come together to varying degrees of success. But yeah, I mean, that just continues all the way through to the end. That's your main arc of your story, is when all of these people come together. And I think it's beautifully set up all the way through. So when that does happen, you really feel it by the end of the film. There is surprisingly quite a lot of heart to this movie. It is a comedy film, but I'm sure we'll talk about it as we go through all the characters individually. But like the opening scene, you sit down for a Guardians of the Galaxy film and you're like, am I in the right film? Is this like a hard-hitting drama film? So it still hits all the beats and, you know, doesn't shy away from those dramatic moments, interspersed with the comedy, of course, as well.
Keeping with the kind of team dynamics and everything like that, the characters feel individual. And I know that's an unusual statement to say, but every single character in this film feels like they've got their own story that is worthy of a film in itself. And they do such a good job of managing to contain all the stories put together into one film. And I guess extending into the second film where they kind of answer the questions that were set up in this one. But all the characters feel so different and so unique. Obviously, we have Star-Lord, Peter Quill, as the main character, but you could have easily said that any of the other characters have a worthy enough storyline to be kind of the main plot-centric point of the film in itself. You have Drax with his revenge, you've got Gamora with her kind of revenge. Even with Rocket and Groot, they're just kind of in it for the money and they want the big score. All of those seem to work. And like you said, the characters shouldn't work together. There is conflict throughout this film, there's conflict throughout the sequel as well. And I like that as part of the team dynamic. It wouldn't be fun if it was just like a team that just came together and there was no kind of grief between them or anything like that, no beef or anything at all. You need that kind of tongue-in-cheek attitude between each other to be able to make it work. And it just so happens to come together through happenstance. And yeah, the team just works.
Yeah, I think I agree with what you said there today. I think like the individuality bleeds through so much. Like, I think there's a reason why Star-Lord, who's the quote-unquote main character of the film, is barely anyone's favourite, and it's because the rest of them are written so well as well. Like, every single character is given almost exactly the same amount. It feels like the amount of same time of screen time, because you feel like you've got to know them all the same. Like, I think when you talk about having heart bleed through the film as well, it's like James Gunn manages to like so beautifully meld the heart through the comedy. So like you get that moment with Drax and Rocket where they're supposed to be drunk and they're betting and gambling, and then Rocket just comes out with that speech about how like he feels like a monster, or he's been treated like a monster, and you just have those little like tidbits of sort of humanity dropped into a film, which is completely like, it's complete bonkers, isn't it, really? Like, when you talk about Raccoon and the tree and, you know, the girl from Avatar who's now green, like, anyone that doesn't know about Marvel will be like, what? It's literally what is going on. But Gunn just manages to, like, meld it all together so beautifully. I just think it's, I think there's a reason why it's in so many people's top 10, I'd say. Like, I'd definitely be in my top 10.
No, definitely. And I think as well, I'm going to say I think this film is faultlessly cast. Aside from the villain, which isn't the actor's fault at all, the cast in this are superb. And I don't even want to go from one by one, kind of jumping what you guys know about Star-Lord. I kind of had said earlier, Chris Pratt, you know, was that guy that was in Parks and Rec at the time. He was in these supporting roles. You may remember him from one moment in Wanted back in 2008. He was always the sidekick comedy relief character supporting role. And this was the big film. This was this guy is going to be the leading man. And it's when you see that he got in shape, he changed everything for this. Now, this was filmed, I think, filming for this started just before he was officially cast in Jurassic World as well. But once they probably got word of how funny this guy was, how natural it was, I remember no one really has that conversation now, but do you remember the Chris Pratt's playing Indiana Jones rumors that have been around for the last like 5-6 years? Because he actually looked a bit like him as well, and not a bit like Harrison Ford, but more like the character trope. And I think the fact that James Gunn took a big risk, because that's not your A-lister. You know, look at so many other Marvel films where they have gone for the more unknown stuff, but they've always surrounded the actors with the big names. But you think for the riskiest one of them all, you'd want a big name to play it safe that can draw in that crowd. And nope, they got the supporting comedy guy. And off the back of him, what's genius is, obviously, you know, Gamora, we obviously knew from a lot of films that she's been in. So Saldana, obviously, the Avatar was the funny one because is the now she's green type thing, and she's been in a couple of action films. But to me at the time, I remember the big deal personally was bringing in Vin Diesel and Bradley Cooper as Rocket and Groot, because this was this big risk. And obviously, think back to 2013 time, you know, Bradley Cooper's hot on the back of his Oscar nominations. He's still a phenomenal actor, but was when they said Bradley Cooper's voicing this raccoon. Everyone's like, what? Vin Diesel's voicing a tree. What? But that kind of curiosity would still bring people in, even if they weren't sure what it was about. And I think who they went for in these supporting roles, in these lead roles as well, Batista, he'd not done much before Guardians in terms of acting. I think he'd been in that really awful action film, I can't remember it, Man of the Iron Fist. I think he'd been in that. But he wasn't a conventional choice for that role. And every single person that was cast in this was absolutely perfect. And we look back again, we've said it so many times across the series already, but you can't recast them. Like, they are so intrinsically that character already. They own it and let them have it. And the beauty of this is that what Marvel's done, I guess, in the sequel and other Marvel films is that what makes the Guardians so great is that they bring people in to interact with them. You want to keep them as this core unit, but it's how they talk to other people that aren't one of their own. And I think that's where it works. But I think it all starts with Chris Pratt, to be fair, that he showed his maturity. You know you're going to get the comedy, but can he hit those dramatic moments? I think he did more than anyone thought he could.
Yeah, and all the characters, like even visually as well, are right off the page. I always talk about that I think you should stay true as much as possible to the comic book counterpart, and pretty much all of like the main core cast look exactly like how they do off the comic book. So again, it's that love for the source material and translating that perfectly through either CGI when it comes to Groot or Rocket, or through the actors that they chose to play the characters. See, I didn't have that sort of backstory, if you will, with Chris Pratt. Like, I still, as of recording this, have not seen Parks and Rec yet. It is on my list of things to watch. So I know that his reputation from that, you know, a lot of people were excited to see him in this. But I was aware of his physical transformation because, Jesus Christ, fair play to him. Like, that guy got in the gym. He got given this opportunity and he made it happen. So fair play to any actor that does that or gets in shape for a role. But yeah, and he's able to take that and translate it. He's able to hit the dramatic moments. I don't want to say it gets really dramatic, but there's enough in there just to keep it interesting. And it's often, I always find this is the case with other big ensemble films. I promise this is going to be like the last Lord of the Rings comparison that I mentioned. But even with that film, actors that you would never imagine to be cast in a film, they just work so well together. And I often think that's the case with a big ensemble film, where there's all these actors from, you might recognize that person from that. This person might be a complete unknown. This person might not have done much acting before, but there's something about it, whether it's the script, the direction, or whether it's maybe just the band. I don't know how these actors got on with each other on set, whether it doesn't seem like there's any animosity between everyone. You get the impression that they all get on with each other off camera as well, and probably are able to take some of that banter and introduce it into the film quite naturally as well.
Yeah, I was actually wondering when I heard about the cast going into the film and everything like that, one of the big things was, what was Bradley Cooper going to sound like? And I kind of guessed that Vin Diesel, I did a little bit of research and stuff like that and saw, okay, so Groot basically just says three lines. So it's going to be just the same delivery and over again. And I was actually quite surprised when it came to the film. I can't remember watching one of the behind the scenes videos, how many lines he actually recorded for Groot and how many different takes of just saying the words I am and Groot after each other in the various different styles that he said them. But I remember it being quite a high number. But with Bradley Cooper as Rocket, I was wondering what kind of delivery he would do. It was after Silver Linings Playbook. It was after, I want to say, one or two of the films from the Hangover franchise.
Yeah.
But was completely unsure on how he was going to play and how he's going to do it. And I was pleasantly surprised. It was reasonably distinguishable. Like, if you listen to voices and stuff like that from film without actually seeing the character, you hear that voice, you know immediately it's Rocket Raccoon, which is very scary for a film like this, that he was able to pull that off and everything like that. But yeah, that's kind of my kind of pre-thought from what was going into the film.
Yeah, I think this says a lot about the trust that Kevin Feige had in such a risky script, that their two biggest bankable names, Vin Diesel and Bradley Cooper, are left off screen completely. Like, it shows the trust, and also the trust that obviously he gave to James Gunn to go out and to cast who he wanted to cast. Like, I think Chris Pratt was in a final three with Glenn Howerton from Always Sunny and someone else. I can't remember who it is. But you can't, like, you struggle to picture anyone else as that now, don't you, really? And then Amanda Seyfried was offered the role of Gamora, wasn't she, by James Gunn, but she turned it down because she said actually wouldn't be able to see how a film with a talking tree and a talking raccoon wouldn't ruin her career. To be fair, that was a fair enough assumption for her to make, I think. And then obviously it gets passed down to Zoe Saldana, and again, you can't see anyone else playing that now. Like, you don't look at Zoe Saldana and think, you don't look at that and think, you don't look at her, sorry, and think Avatar anymore, do you? Like, you think Gamora. And I think it works on a level where in your dramatic moment, in your comedic moments, you lean on your best comedic actors, and in your dramatic moments, you lean on your best dramatic actors. And I think that's why a lot of the weight falls on the likes of Karen Gillan and Gamora and that relationship, because like Zoe Saldana and Karen Gillan are probably the two best dramatic actors on set for me in that film.
Yeah, what I wanted to actually talk about, Kevin Feige, I was trying to do some research, but I've not been able to find it. We know, going back two films, which was, you know, a year before this, really, there was a hell of a lot of production issues with Thor: The Dark World. And that was very much at that stage of Marvel, kind of with Paramount still at this point. You know, Disney bought them, but nothing official. It wasn't complete Disney. This was one of the first 100% Disney-owned this franchise. Kevin Feige is in charge. No one questioned him. No one tells him what to do. And kind of going for using the fact that he had the trust in James Gunn to get it done. And obviously, we did get issues on a following Marvel film, which is Ant-Man. But after Ant-Man, there's pretty much no issues. And I think when you've got that sole creative head, the directors can come on board and say, you know, I'm going to follow a Marvel path to a point, but I'm going to get some freedom to do what I want. If I'm being hired to do this project, he's going to leave me to it. And that's the way he works. And I think that's a massive part of this. If you had a studio breathing down James Gunn's neck, I think the film could be very, very different. I could easily, not to hide, sort of, you know, pontificate years down the line, but it's going back to that stuff that why would you want, you know, Vin Diesel and Bradley Cooper, aliases, and not show them? Why would you put the comic guy that we've seen as supporting role is the lead role? There's so many questions going into it. Again, the talking tree, the talking raccoon. So many logical issues, but they took that risk and it paid off. And even the money this made, I think this ended up making more than The Winter Soldier, which said a hell of a lot when they came out in the same year, a couple of months apart. It just, to me, this is a game changer for the MCU, for everything that followed. Let's ignore the villain of this film. Let's speak about a bigger villain that gets his kind of first introduction in this one. We get Josh Brolin as Thanos very briefly, kind of teasing. I don't know if you guys remember the announcement. It was like, oh, Josh Brolin's going to voice Thanos in Guardians. And it was that kind of curious, like, oh, okay, like I can see that. Like, he's got a bit of a, what's the word, a presence. And I think there's definitely a difference in performance, CGI side, like even voice and tone from this and Endgame, and in, well, Infinity War as well. But the fact they brought in Brolin, they were still teeing up the bigger picture for Marvel that, yes, James can have these freedoms, but they obviously politely said, hey, Chuck, we need to know about the Infinity Stones. We need this weird guy called the Collector. We need Thanos in here to set some stuff up, especially when one of your main characters is the daughter of Thanos. There was still stuff they had to do to fit inside that MCU world, and I think he nailed it with precision because it was that space one, because it was so different. You never get too many scenes with Thanos. You're kind of not left wanting more because he doesn't have a lot to do. However, in this sort of, as an introduction to him, you know he's got a presence when he swivels in that chair and he's wearing his armor. Obviously, down the line, it's just a bit different, but it's one of them where even bringing him in, I think, was ballsy, because if this film hadn't have worked and had backfired and no one saw it or they all hated it, there's your villain that's going to be leading the next sort of 4 years of Marvel films. You're building up to this guy. This film had to work for him to even get more credibility.
I'm actually surprised that the MCU before this point didn't sort of like tease Thanos a little bit more, because when you look at it as a whole, he really doesn't get much of anything of substance really until Infinity War happens and we get like the full reveal in that. Like, I know he does crop up here. You had like the end credit scene of the first Avengers film, but it's all very much in shadows. If you're a newcomer to this and you don't know who Thanos is, then I don't know. I would argue that maybe they could have set him up more. He could have cropped up a little bit more. We could have had more scenes like this one really to like build up to him. But it is strange now watching this film again after we've had Infinity War and after we've had Endgame, because yeah, it is completely different. And I think he only gets like, does he get the one scene in this film or like a handful of scenes, I think. And you're right, the look, and maybe that's why, you know, Brolin does a fine performance. He can voice act if he wants to. And I'm wondering if they didn't get him in motion capture, if that was like a disconnect there with the performance, because it looks like it's all just completely created digitally in this one and looks like they haven't got that motion capture with him. I'm not aware of it, if he was or if he wasn't, but you can tell they were still trying to maybe work out at this point what they really wanted to do with Thanos. It is a change of appearance from even the first time that we saw him at the end of Avengers. It kind of works though, because that was just like over the shoulder shot, and you know, we've had so many films in between that you're not gonna distinctly remember that one moment. But it is interesting. Maybe they could do like a special edition thing in the future and update it. It's still visually Thanos though, you know, he's still got the chin, he's still kind of like a purple guy, different shade of purple, but it's still the same dude. I will say, just overall, this is like my biggest negative with this film. We'll talk about the main villain in a second, but it is the villain, the enemy side of this film, you know, across the board with, you know, Thanos gets one scene and he's kind of there just to set up things to come. The Collector, you know, he's a quirky character and then he's out of the movie. And then, well, we'll get onto Lee Pace's character in just a second. But it was cool seeing Thanos again, especially sort of going back to this film. Because when I first saw this, I was kind of clueless. I knew that Thanos had a thing called the Infinity Gauntlet, but I didn't know much beyond that point. So it was just, oh, there's a character that people know. But now, going back, it's cool to see a lot of these setups. And there are even setups for villains to come in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, which I wasn't aware of at the first time that I watched this, which I'm sure we'll talk about towards the end. But it's always good seeing Thanos. He's a cool character.
I think they actually paced Thanos' story quite well across the entire Infinity Saga. I mean, we get a little bit of a tease kind of through him using people as pawns and using Loki and kind of the attack on New York and everything like that. And you get that little shot of him kind of twisting around and everything like that. And that's kind of the first introduction. It reminded me a lot of the Fire Lord Ozai in the Last Airbender series, because you don't see his face until basically the end of the first season. You have all of that build up, all of that hype going into this evil, menacing character, and then you're given very little snippets of him as an introduction almost halfway through the entire saga as a whole. I quite like that. I think that's quite nice because it builds up the myth behind the character before actually introducing the character. And when this character was introduced, I mean, you said with the chair swivel, it's menacing. You immediately know he's in charge of the situation. You immediately get that kind of sense of grandeur from him. And sure, the performance isn't as probably as big as the performance that Josh Brolin gave in later films such as Infinity War and such as Endgame. But as far as what the information we needed to know at the time was for Thanos, it was perfect. It was really good. I'm sure we're going to talk about Ronan next time around. But yeah, I will say as well, that is probably the one negative from this film is the villains and the lack of, I guess, Nebula's really the only good villain you could say in this film that really stands out.
Yeah, no, I'd agree with that. I think when you can sort of like push Lee Pace to one side, push Ronan to one side, really, and focus on Nebula, and you think like it's not too much of an issue that the villain side of this is a bit shaky, because we still get a well-rounded villain. It just happens to be someone who we know at this point now doesn't really want to be a villain because it's Nebula. And it works sort of, Ronan is a pawn. He is a pawn of Thanos. We know that obviously Thanos is not as fleshed out in this film. Like, I agree with what you say. Like, they may go back and retcon what he looks like, because it is such a departure from what we actually know he looks like now. But I think that's because I was listening to an interview with Josh Brolin a few years ago, and I remember him saying that Kevin Feige said to him, and James Gunn said, just stick with us, like, and we promise we'll give you your own film, which turned out to be Infinity War, which he would lead. They were like, we don't really have the plan as of yet, because obviously we know up till, was it Age of Ultron and beyond, that they were unsure how far they were going to be able to push this entire thing. So to be able to push it as far as they did, and then to give Brolin and Thanos the film that the character deserved, I think it ended up, whether they meant it or not, working out that they did pace the storyline almost perfectly up to a point where people were like, oh, he is the big bad, and he is the ultimate villain of this entire Avengers story.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Thanos, because I remember at the time, even pre-Infinity, where they're like, oh, Thanos he's the lead character's film. You're kind of like, yeah, good one, it's called the Avengers, of course he's not the main villain, and I remember kind of the Infinity, like, oh my word, like, we've just got like the deepest villain story I've ever seen for a blockbuster not an ensemble. Yeah, it is an ensemble with like God knows how many people, but the villain that we've known for like 10 minutes was the core of it. And the Josh Brolin stuff is great because I think they're now the casting for him, and it's also good when they're paying that faith back to him that, you know, as you said, they will be ready. He will get a film. And I think with Brolin, he strikes me kind of back to that, you know, it was probably a day's of voice work for him. It probably wasn't much effort, but he seems like the kind of guy, he's happy to do blockbuster films, smaller films, comedies, dramas, even westerns have seen him do that. He can do a lot of things. And I think as an introduction to what comes, absolutely nailed that character for when we get to the big one, which is we're only about 8-9 films away at this point. God knows it's going too quick. Let's talk. I want to talk Nebra actually before we get to Ronan in the Yakuza. Because in this film, she is very much a two-dimensional villain, not as an insult, but she's not the lead villain, and she has got a personal character arc to another character. And you know, there's something there, and you can tell that kind of from the get-go, even those passing comments when she's, you know, when Dennis is like, you know, they've took my favorite daughter, and she's kind of, Karen Gillan is always, for a supporting role, giving it well. And I wonder if there was plans for her, if they said to her that, listen, you're going to be a supporting role, but if there's a sequel, you're going to have this expanded role, because it seems to me like James Gunn has a pretty specific story structure that, you know, the way this film finishes, and we know that in canon, they've said that Guardians 2 set a couple of months after. It feels like as if he probably actually had written like both these films together, that what they're teasing at the end of the film is a key point of the next one. Everything from being able to touch the Infinity Stone to the Celestials to the mixtapes and Nebula. It feels like there was always a plan for more. Now, I might be completely wrong, and I might think, you know, it's being over the top, but I do have that on that rewatch thinking, wow, this really did tee up a lot of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. And of course, you know, the Infinity Saga does come after that, which I guess helped it even more. But I don't know if any of you guys clocked that as well.
Yeah, definitely. I noticed like a lot of things being set up for not just like the Avengers films, but especially Guardians of the Galaxy 2. And I think if you're going to look at all these chronologically, it does take place very quickly after, doesn't it? I think you can pretty much go straight from this onto the next one. I remember seeing this for the first time, and obviously sort of reviewing this in isolation is very totally different from reviewing this once you've seen the entire MCU saga at this point. I didn't really care for Nebula the first time I watched this. She works well. I like the sibling rivalry, and I like that that dynamic between the two, how there is a favorite and then one's been, you know, completely ripped, like Rocket Raccoon in a way, ripped apart, put back together, ripped apart, put back together again. But we don't really get much of that until we get to the sequel. So I think Nebula is a character that, as the films go on, and we get, I think she's easily the best thing in Guardians of the Galaxy 2 as well. I do prefer Guardians of the Galaxy 1 to the second one, I will say that, but I think that Nebula is by far and away the most interesting thing in that sequel. So I have to kind of review it from both sides, really. In isolation of this film, she's just like a henchman, and she's fine, and she serves that role well. Karen Gillan is great, though, but as the films go on, we get way more depth, even into Endgame as well, some of the stuff with her. She is one of the most interesting characters from this sort of like realm, from this space side of the films. But yeah, no, I mean, Karen Gillan's great. I too watched the first series that she was in of Doctor Who. And, you know, I thought she was fine in that. But yeah, complete transformation. Like, she's a great actress. I don't think she gets enough credit for the acting that she does. But yeah, even like physicality as well. Like, I don't know how many of her own stunts that she did in this, but in terms of the fight sequences, I think she does kind of throw herself. Well, I know definitely she threw herself into this role. But yeah, no, an interesting character, but I think in isolation, there's not much to her within this one film at the moment.
I think this film did a very good job of setting a base for her character,
yeah,
and giving you just the bare basics that you needed to go on with for the later films where they would develop her character. I think you're on something here, George, by saying that they were probably planning a sequel and planning stuff on from then with this film. I did have a very, very quick check just to make sure. And I think The Incredible Hulk is the only film which didn't actually get a sequel before Guardians of the Galaxy came out, other than The Avengers, but they already announced that Age of Ultron was going to be coming out. So pretty much every single Marvel film was getting a sequel or getting a continuation of their story. So maybe James Gunn looked at that and thought, well, most of the films are doing quite well. They're getting continuations, stuff like that. If I'm able to plan out where I want the story to go, obviously consult with the entire saga storyline and where that, what direction that's going in, then you can easily weave that story in together. And I think the characters in this film, especially the villain side of things, I mean, all three villains from this film that you could talk about do come back in later films or do have extra stuff added onto them. So I don't know whether it was just a ground job that they needed doing with the characters and they didn't give much of everyone and maybe split too much kind of resources between just setting up their stories for later films instead of focusing on one of them being kind of the main thing for this. But yeah, I feel like that continuation was possibly always planned.
Yeah, I mean, I think it comes from James Gunn leaving himself enough threads and enough plot points to be able to go in the direction of a sequel if it was given to him. And you imagine, like, when we get news that a sequel is being greenlit, that is months after they've been told. You can imagine the moment, like, you'd imagine the moment Kevin Feige sat down and watched that first test screening of Guardians that it was given to him. Like, as we know now, he is smart enough to see good films, so he would have known he had a hit on his hands. And you'd imagine the first thing he would have done is tell James Gunn, I want to hire you for this again. Can you get work? Can you get work on it straight away? And like, they might have ended up weaving some stuff back and forth into the final finished product of the first film as well. But we know that at this point now, they plan stuff so far in advance. It's like Kevin Feige's playing 4D chess and we all just watch, really.
No, definitely the perfect analogy. Before we get to the Infinity, let's give him his time, shall we? I want to try and say his voice in his horrible, weird, possessive tone, but I shan't. It's Ronan the Accuser. I love the character design. Let's go into that. It's not Lee Pace's fault. He's caked in so many layers of makeup. What can he really do underneath it? He's probably had a great time on set. This is very much the... I'm not going to say it's a phase two problem, but for many years, Marvel had an issue with their villains that we were loving those heroes so much that not that they were getting the villains wrong, but we never really had a villain to sort of match, you know, what those guys are that who can help take it to the next level. And certainly I think phase three corrected a lot of that. But I think not that I'm going to let it slide because it is probably the worst point of this film. But when I think you've got this solid origin film that's giving sort of 5-6 characters their own sub storylines, their personal issues, bringing them together, having individual character arcs which kind of come together at the end. They're not necessarily resolved as such, but we get certainly an acceptance of where they are within their storylines. Ronan's this kind of not even afterthought, but I'm just going to talk about Batista because I love the whole concept that, you know, before we had the I didn't even know who you are line, we did have Ronan, you know, I didn't remember your wife and daughter. And I love the fact that he was so personal to Batista that this is the guy that killed his daughter and his wife. And one of the funniest lines of the film, which probably sums him up as a villain, is that when they kill him at the end and Batista's like, well, I just want to kill Thanos because this is the guy that just worked for him instead. Great line, but it kind of sums him up as a villain that it's just really irrelevant to the bigger picture.
Yeah, he's one of the most boring kind of villains, not just in Marvel, but just in terms of villains to put in a film. We pretty much get like this really quick couple of sentence monologue at the beginning as he's donning his costume and sort of preparing for battle. And that we just get all of his history just dumped in an exposition dump. It's just my people were killed and I want revenge. And he gets his hammer and out he goes for revenge and that's it. And then he's one of those villains where we'll periodically cut back to him throughout the film for maybe like a 30-second quick scene just to remind you of his presence, that he's still evil and he still wants revenge and he's still going to conquer the world. And it's just such a boring villain that, I mean, the look of him's fine, but it's just down to the writing. It's just that he's not really given anything of substance. And there are villains of all different kinds. My favorite ones I always keep saying are the ones that are connected in some way to the main, you know, hero, like the Winter Soldier, for example, intrinsically linked to Captain America. Even other things, you know, like Joker to Batman or whatever, it's always a villain that either has a similar psychology or, you know, they either have like the same agendas but want to go about them in completely different ways. They're always way more of the interesting villains to me. And this is just, you know, your bottom of the barrel. We need a guy who's bad because he's bad and evil and he's going to do bad and evil things throughout the rest of the film. Lee Pace is a great actor, really, really good actor. And, you know, he can really, you know, throw himself into, and especially acting under all that costume and the makeup and everything, you know, fair play to him. But his character's just not given anything, you know, no gravitas, no presence, really. He just sucks the life out of the screen every time he's on. And even like the way that the villain's taken out, and this is where, to me, like, the humor is great in this film, but I think this isn't just, you know, at this film's expense. I think this is over quite a few Marvel films. Sometimes the humor can get away in the way of the drama and detract from it. And when you get to that dance off scene at the end, I can't stand it. That's a step too far for me. I know people like it, but for me, rewatching it, because I didn't know how it would go over this time watching it, but I cringed back in the day when that scene happened, and I cringed to get at it. It's just, it just completely, not emasculates, that's the wrong word, but it just takes any presence that the villain would have, and it just makes them a laughing stock. It's the same thing with Loki in Avengers, where the Hulk like smashes him, but Loki's always been that kind of a character who's in and over his head, who isn't a physically imposing villain. So seeing him get completely destroyed by the Hulk is funny, but it does take away from a truly imposing villain who is a threat, and you do feel threatened by, and there is peril there for the villains. You never get that sense with Ronan in this film. We even had to Google his name. We couldn't even remember his proper full title before doing this review. That shows how memorable this character is. It's easily the weakest thing in this film for me. I'd say, actually, to the credit of Guardians of the Galaxy 2, and maybe this is down to the charisma of Kurt Russell, but I do think they did improve slightly the villain side of things into the second film, but yeah, it's a shame. The rest of the film's still good because there's so much other good stuff in the film, but if I am going to pick a negative, I think pretty much across the board, people would always say that Ronan's the weakest thing in this film.
I love the dance-off to save the universe, and I'm going to be very unapologetic about it. I actually think that it's one of Star-Lord's best kind of character traits that he has, that he doesn't just want to win the day. He does want to humiliate the villain. There are certain scenes where he doesn't take the final fight scene, stuff like that, very seriously. He doesn't take kind of his mission seriously. I always think of the Pac-Man bit in the second Guardians of the Galaxy film, where it's just like, okay, he's in a massive fight, but he isn't taking it seriously. Dance off to save the universe, he isn't taking it seriously. Even when he faces off against Thanos, he does not take it seriously. Like, the first time they meet, he calls him Grimace to his face. He's kind of making a few jokes and everything like that whilst his girlfriend's being threatened. The second time he meets him, he's being really cocky, saying, oh, it was my plan all along and stuff like that, before he goes into kind of talking to Thanos about Gamora. That is how he deals with kind of pain, and that's how he deals with the villains that are around him. So that's why I absolutely adore the dance-off to save the universe. As far as Ronan's concerned, it is a very blank character. And I feel like the only threatening thing from his character is the fact that he has an Infinity Stone. And that is such a big thing, because we don't really have too much of an introduction to the Infinity Stones. We've seen them, but we haven't had them properly, fully explained yet. And they do kind of get a better explanation in this film, with the Collector kind of giving a brief history on them and everything like that. But the villain isn't as big as the kind of threat of the Infinity Stones. Once we see the power of the Infinity Stones, and once we see what he's after, and once we see him start to kind of use kind of the power that he gets from the stone, that's where he becomes a more threatening villain. But before that point, he is completely cookie cutter. I think his performance does get better throughout the film. I think it's very kind of bland at the start, and it does start to get some things towards the end. But he is a very basic villain in that same sense.
Yeah, I think as far as Ronan goes, it's almost built to be like the best thing he could do to have the most impact in this film would have been to be killed by Thanos, to show us how powerful Thanos is, and that Ronan was just a tiny ant to a boot, if you will. And what you're saying about Star-Lord as well, it's like everything you two have said is absolutely right, because what Don Cheadle says in Endgame, like, he's an idiot. That is literally his character trait. He is a moron. Like, he's brilliant, and like, you love some of the stuff he does, and you love and hate some of the stuff he does and the decisions he makes. But inherently, he's just got that childlike nature to him. But I think what you say about the way Ronan's written as a character and sort of villains throughout Marvel as a whole, I think it comes down to screenwriter, doesn't it? Like, if you look at Marcus and McFeely, like, you can tell throughout Infinity War and Endgame that they love Captain America. They've written Captain America. You can tell that they lean towards him. He gets great lines. You can tell that James Gunn loves the Guardians of the Galaxy. He intrinsically gives them absolutely everything to do. And he gives Ronan almost nothing. And it's almost like, I know you're not going to be here. I don't really need you. And that's sort of how it comes across.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I'm going to jump in. Sorry, Chris. I also love the dance off. However,
3-1.
I believe it is also cringe. It's that Ricky Gervais office cringe humor that it's so uncomfortable. That's what makes it so funny. And I still remember, you know, the what are you doing? That was like everyone the first time they saw it. But and also what you said, Theo, you know, he's a moron. Let's not forget that there would be no click if he hadn't have punched Thanos in the face in Infinity War. Let's not forget that. To the point where I think did Chris Pratt have to like delete Instagram comments because he was getting so much abuse back when the film came out? Something that ridiculous. I can't remember. Someone will, but that's what I love. They are just these absolute morons come together in dire circumstances. I think that's why they work. Briefly, before we talk about the Infinity, I really want to quickly talk about Yondu, actually, because I hadn't seen Walking Dead. I still haven't. I've seen the pilot. Loads of my friends. Is it Merle he plays? Like one of my best friends.
Yeah.
He was like, it's Merle. And I was like, I don't know who that is. It's like, he's got a really cool arrow thing. And I love Yondu in this, that he's a very small role. Also, let's talk Sean Gunn. Sorry. Sean Gunn with him. The only thing I'll say, this isn't a criticism at all, because I absolutely adore Bradley Cooper. I think the whole world knows that the one thing James Gunn probably lost was I'm sure that Sean Gunn was meant to voice Rocket. He motion captured him in every film he's been in. He was on set every day. I don't know if it's ever been outright said, but I believe there'd been a lot of rumors at the time that Sean Gunn was also meant to voice Rocket, and that's why he's got a bigger role in the second film. I love him playing the really weird, like he's basically a hillbilly in space, isn't he, guys? And I like that stuff, but Michael Rooker as Yondu is great. He's got a presence as well, like that mentor figure. However, when they build up the arrow thing, I know it's more of a favorite scene, but they build up the arrow whistle so well that just get that moment. And then I think sort of going into expectation maybe for the second one, because you've already seen this big gimmick, it's like, okay, you've done that, now you have to do it on a bigger and a better scale. How are you going to be able to do that? So Yondu's a really, I think, underrated supporting character in the MCU, actually. Now I'm kind of thinking about it, that there's a rightful place for him. He gets a great arc, and I still think his death's quite sad in the second film. Spoiler alert for those that aren't in the loop. But don't know if anyone wants to speak about Yondu. If not, we can talk about the Infinity Stone, because this is Tayte.
Oh, yeah. No, I was going to jump in on Yondu. I think he's a brilliant character. He does have some humor elements thrown in and everything like that. He does seem like that kind of that anti-hero, that underlying threat. You know that he is friends with Peter, but at the same time, you don't know how much they trust each other and everything like that. And there is that level of mistrust throughout the entire film. That does develop further into the second film, and we kind of learn a bit more about their history and their backstory and everything like that between them. And I think his character gets a lot more to do in the second film, but just the introduction of his character, just the presence of his character in the first film does benefit his further later developments in the second film.
No, definitely. Let's talk Infinity Stones. The Collector. I love Benicio Del Toro. I love him in The Last Jedi, and I love him in this. Sorry, I had to bring that up. We're at this stage of the MCU where, you know, we'd all heard of the Infinity Saga, right? They'd announced, I think Phase 3 had already been announced before this film came out, maybe. No, I'm wrong on that. It wasn't. It was just after. We know that this gauntlet, you know, if we didn't know at the time, we know there's going to be a gauntlet and there's got to be these six stones, and we can't just have an explanation in Infinity War. It needs something. And bringing in the Collector, you know, comic-wise, that is very much a character that is integral to Thanos' story. And I would imagine at the time they probably had plans for the Collector to be in both Infinity Saga, whatever. I'd imagine the original idea was probably have the Collector get them to give to Thanos or to have them robbed or something. But obviously this is more of a one in scene. We get a brief cameo in Infinity War where he waves at the camera, and as he reality kicks in, he's not there all along, which is a shame. But getting this introduction, it's like this, the celestial beings they speak about. I love that kind of, I know it's an exposition dump and I know that it's really irrelevant to that film, but I like the fact that they get this amazing build up, the set design and everything. The how about you've got like Easter eggs, like there's dark elves in the cages, because do you remember we all forgot about those after Thor the Dark World, and loads of other stuff going on. I wish we'd have got more from Benicio Del Toro. I think he's a great actor. I think he's very good playing very... I don't even want to say he's a character actor. He can kind of jump in and do anything. Like, we've seen him in so many films, starting out younger on James Bond, see him in action films, look at him in Sicario, they look at him in things like this, Last Jedi. There's so much sort of, not even depth in, but he's willing to kind of play that flamboyant, weird guy. And he can do it in a great way where you want more from him. And he does have that serious undertone where he's talking to his slaves about, you know, what happened to the last one. Kind of like Jabba's Hutt, not Jabba's Hutt, like Jabba's Palace, that you imagine him like sort of manning the checkouts there. I don't mind the exposition dump. I think where the cinematic universe was at the time, you needed to have a discussion in phase two. And the best place for the audience at home to get a sort of inkling of what's to come is through something like that. Just giving the Infinity Saga a really vague origin, words on the screen, let's move on, and it will crop up over the next few years. But now the people at home, every time one Infinity Saga does appear in phase three, they're going to know what that's leading up to.
Yeah, I think it was necessary for this film, especially purely, you know, factor simple that you have an Infinity Stone in the film. You need some kind of context as to what it is, where it came from. And even now, like looking ahead into phase four, I'm sure we'll get like another callback to this film where you've got the Celestials, because I think that's going to be in the Eternals, if I'm remembering correctly. You know, you've got that huge towering Goliath thing with the staff or the hammer, and it's like, oh, that, I can't wait to watch that in phase four. And this is in phase two, so just shows how far they're planning ahead, even if they ever thought they'd get to an Eternals film. But it is an exposition dump, but I think it's necessary for this film, and you do kind of get a reaffirmation when you get to Infinity War anyway. Gamora kind of gives you the rundown again. Say if you've missed this film and you go into Infinity War, I don't know if anyone did, because that would be that would be experience if you don't know anything before going into that film, but they give you context within that film as well. But this is just like good to have for this film, and does in fact set you up. I think it's necessary because you've got people like Thanos, you've got things and storylines and the overarching main story of the Infinity Saga as a whole, kind of, you could say, originating from this film. I know that you have Infinity Stones before this, but this is the first cosmic space one, which is going to intrinsically tie into that. So I don't have a problem with that. And yeah, Benicio del Toro is great. I would have loved to have seen him more within these films. He's probably the most Benicio del Toro is in this film. I can imagine him being like this in real life, the very flamboyant, over-the-top personality. He is in this film very quickly, though. But, you know, his impact is remembered. He is a very memorable character, sort of visually. It reminds me of a film that I've watched recently. Who's the David Bowie guy from Tron Legacy? That kind of flamboyant camp character that you just remember from the film. I always love characters like that in films because they do stay with you from the film.
Go for it.
All right, Michael Sheen. Tron, guys. Watch Tron Legacy. Annual reminder.
I will back that as well. As far as the Infinity Stones were concerned, they kind of had to kind of play the card of, we need to explain what they are to the audience going into Age of Ultron, because otherwise people would not know what was going on in that film. Because a lot of that film was to do with the Mind Stone and with Vision and with Ultron trying to get that power and everything like that, and having that understanding of what the stone actually was and what power it held. You needed that, and the best way of doing that was maybe a film that was set in space, maybe set out there where the kind of wider knowledge of the universe could be expanded. It's very difficult to go into, say, a Captain America film and suddenly drop kind of, oh, Infinity Stones, this is what they are, this is what all of them are, and have a character that has that knowledge of all of them be able to kind of exposition dump it off, but also feel natural. And I think this film was the best fit for that because it was set in space. You had Thanos in the film anyway, who was after the stones. You have a stone that is one of the things that is needed to be collected. So I feel like that timing-wise was kind of when it needed to be put in.
Yeah, and I think like when you look at it, it's tough to like use all that exposition and keep your story going at the same time, because obviously you have to put that in. But I think he does a pretty decent job of that. Like, you get the sort of story of Benicio del Toro and, well, the Collector, and his sort of like oppression for his servants or whatever, and how he's oppressed them, and like to demonstrate the power of the stone by showing her hold it and then be destroyed is sort of like, it moves both the MCU forward and the story of that film, because obviously we'll see Quill hold it later on. So you've got to dump exposition at some point, and especially when you've got another 8-9 films on their way.
No, exactly. I'm actually going to bring something up with Spider Rule. At the time of recording, there's been some keyword leak from the Eternals. I say leak, it's not spoilers, so I'm going to bring up. Here is the one of the first Eternals promos. I'm not sure if anyone's seen this photo online. We have this sort of being of the six eyes. I'm going to bring up the shot from Guardians of the Galaxy. Apparently, that's going to be the same character.
Oh, nice.
Wow. Okay.
So, you know, I'm not going to say they planned an Eternals film back then, but certainly there has always been a story to tell. Now, obviously, also the time of recording, Chloe Zhao is outright favourite to win Best Director at the Oscars as well. And we all know that that first trailer is not going to come until Disney can slap winner of Best Director onto the first trailer. So I don't mind that. But I wanted to bring that just in case no one has seen that at home. In 2 weeks' time, when this goes up, we might have HD copies everywhere. I'm like, absolute fool. But that I thought was worthy of being brought up. We've spoken about the characters, about the stones, about the worlds. I mean, there's so much in this film. We've kind of left out, which is basically a character in itself now, right? The soundtrack to this film, easily one of the most recognizable soundtracks in I'm going to jump a beat and say cinema history now. Now, the Awesome Mix Volume 1 is what I'm talking about more so than the title of its score. I was doing some digging on this. This was the third highest selling vinyl of the decade of the tens. For a film that came out in 2014, now, I'd imagine that the vinyl boom was similar around that time. That's why I started buying them. That's one of the first ones I remember buying. And I wanted to bring that because everyone, I think even people that hadn't seen this film, probably recognized at least that sort of CD vinyl cover. And I think it's a character in itself. The fact we get an almost arc where the film ends with getting us a mixtape volume 2. In fact, Disney would release this on cassette, which I ended up buying as well. There was so much great stuff, but I was blown away by this because when directors say, oh, I've got this great music selection, you kind of like, yeah, well, they always say that. But this one, you know, it is tailored around every moment. You can tell James Gunn's listened to hundreds and thousands of songs. I just need to bring that soundtrack up because it's so iconic.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm glad you mentioned the cassette tape as well, because I think it's the only film, even since like cassette tapes died out, it's like the last death throes of the cassette tape just still clinging on for dear life when this film came out. It's an absolutely tremendous soundtrack. The score I'll get onto in a second, because that's somewhat the main focus is the soundtrack, absolutely. It's not only a great soundtrack in and of itself, you know, full of 60s and 70s rock and pop songs. You've got people on there, you know, Jackson 5, 10cc, David Bowie, just phenomenal, you know, world-class artists on there. It's always a great listen. It's one that you'll listen to beginning to end, but it ties into the story as well, which is why I love it even more. It's not just, you know, oh, we've got this quirky, fun, uplifting soundtrack to go with these characters. It fundamentally ties into Star-Lord's character and his growth and his attachment to his mom, which I think was just an absolutely beautiful choice. And then sort of like the passing of the torch at the end as well, where she gives him volume 2, which sets us up very nicely for the sequel. But I love how they managed to work the music in, because, you know, he's all about music, and you just get the impression that he has listened to this soundtrack again and again and again, purely to like to have some semblance of closeness with his mother, who passed away at the beginning. So it's great how they managed to work that within to the actual fabric of the story as well, on top of being just like a great standalone soundtrack on its own. The score itself, Tyler Bates, you know, he's mostly sort of within the action genre. It's a serviceable score. There's no themes that stand out to me. There's nothing inherently memorable from it. The memorable stuff does come from all of these tremendous artists on the actual soundtrack rather than the score. So, yeah, I'm sure everyone's listened to it by now anyway, especially if it's the third highest selling or listened to album, whatever it is. I know at the time everyone was listening to this thing and getting hyped by it.
Everyone was. I remember when just I would walk into HMV and just the shelves were completely emptied. Like, this was the one CD that was just selling out over and over again. And everyone was listening to it. Like, absolutely everyone, just walking through, looking what people were listening to on their phones, stuff like that. It would always be Awesome Mix Volume 1 or even Awesome Mix Volume 2 later on, everything like that. And it fits so well into the character, especially with, like you said, the kind of link with his mother and the fact that you can tell that he's listened to it over and over again, the fact that he's able to recite facts from the songs. He cares so much about the music. It is part of his identity. The fact that when he needs to escape from the prison, he goes back for the music, and that is the most important thing to him. Like, it's fantastic that they built that into his character. I'm wondering what everyone's favorite from the soundtrack is, though, from Awesome Mix Volume 1.
Ooh, that is, I've got the track list up now. Oh my god.
The Pina Colada song, I think.
That's a good one. I quite like Moon Age Daydream, but I do quite like Fool Around and Fell in Love as well.
I think Come and Get Your Love's probably the one that I remember from the most. I know that Hooked on a Feeling was in the trailer, but that opening title where the title smashes on screen, it's still my hoovering dance song. We all dance when we hoover, don't we? I do when that song comes on anyway. I always think of that.
I was going to say, at the same time, the callback to that in Avengers Endgame is just one of the funniest things.
Great moment. But I think my favourite song, if I had to pick, that's the most memorable one to me, but my favourite actual, in my own personal life, my favourite song on that soundtrack is probably I'm Not In Love by 10cc.
Carry on.
Yeah, I was just going to say, with what you're saying about the callback in Endgame, it's like, there's a reason they call that back. And it's not because people want to see Chris Pratt dance. Like, it's the music, the soundtrack. Like, it is one of the most iconic soundtracks of all time. Like, I moved house a few weeks ago, drove down to London. I had that soundtrack on for at least 20 minutes on my way down here. Like, it's one that will stand the complete test of time, isn't it?
Yeah. It's one of those soundtracks where, like, everyone can recognize songs. Picking a favorite from that, I'm probably the same as you, Chris. Come and Get My Love. That was the one for me where I think, because it's at the start of the film as well. Well, no, it's not 10cc. When you get that moment, so how are you going to introduce this character? That song plays, you know exactly what you're getting from Chris Pratt, using the lizard as a microphone, all of that stuff. That's probably my favorite song. What's weird, I call this the James Bond effect. I'm not going to lie, my knowledge on music is pathetic compared to film. A lot of people probably know this. Like, my family, if I'm driving, their family say, put music on, they know it's going straight to Hans Zimmer playlist. Chris has said many, well, he's had to witness it. it's one of those where I think with this one, it's almost like a character-like, and I think it is that defining instruction to Star-Lord. So you go with that. Obviously, I'm a massive Bowie fan. Getting Moonage Daydream is... Whenever it comes on screen, this sounds horrible. It's sad because James Gunn was going to get Bowie in a cameo for Volume 2. That's been on record a lot. I think he was going to be one of those characters we see at the end of Stallone. And I think when he went and got the rights to get that song in the film, because obviously another thing, he had to go out and get the rights for these songs. He probably didn't for Volume 2. Volume 2 was probably really easy. Hi, Fleetwood Mac, can I use your song? Absolutely, go for it. Whereas Volume 1 was probably a lot harder to get some of those songs. My favorite is Come and Get Your Love, but I love Moonage Daydream. Every song feels like it's played at the right moment, even All Child. Like, cause I think it's at a cringe moment with that comedy moment, the dance off, and the song's obviously actually quite like meant to be emotional-esque, I guess we can say. It's just funny the way Chris Pratt does it, but what an iconic soundtrack, and the fact that you get Volume 2 as well. And even going into Infinity War, when they play Rubber Band Man as well, that's amazing, because the moment that kicks in, you're like, okay, it's time for the Guardians. And it's almost like wrestling. They've got their own entrance music that when they appear, there's going to be a song in play. And I absolutely adore those moments. But yeah, the soundtrack, phenomenal. I don't think, I'm not going to say those are films copied it after and tried the whole, we must have these kind of soundtrack type things. I'm glad that didn't become a trope. I know that Baby Driver is the closest thing to it, but that's more of a story precision. This is a character of Tinnitus, and we need the songs, and that's just Edgar Wright being Edgar Wright, like the entire film. So I'm glad it's not one of those things that took off and became every big blockbuster has a compilation to go with it. Some of them do, but
well, we know one other superhero film that was trying to be this film that tried to follow suit with that, didn't we, with a certain DC film, which now for its sequel has the director from this film with Suicide Squad, where it was, you know, get all those popular songs in that people are going to know. And yeah, so I think hopefully it died with that film. Yes. One film does it well, one film, not so much.
Definitely. What I want to speak about, guys, because we're at this kind of the awkward stage. We always talk about the Stan Lee cameo, everyone's favorite Marvel recurring character, I guess we can say. I love this one because it's sci-fi. It's really brief. I think it's just Rocket taking the piss out of him. But again, it's that like, aha, whoa, we've got it in the first 5 minutes of a film. This is new. Not much to it at all. I think he's chatting up a girl as well. Yeah, he's really young. I love those kind of like Stanley being a bit cringy around the humans. They're the really like, nice ones. I don't know. It's we say it every week. We just like it when he appears, but always bring it up.
It's a fine character. I must admit, it's not one of my favorite cameos of Stanley in this film. It's okay. It's you know, Stanley kind of being like a lecherous old pervert a little bit in it, but it's fine. It's not one of like the main standout ones, like the memorable cameos to me. I think maybe because it is done so quickly within the film, maybe it doesn't sort of stand out to me. Usually it tends to be like the midpoint or somewhere around there.
Yeah, it's very brief. He doesn't actually get any lines in it as well, which I think is why possibly it doesn't stand out as much as the others. It's just kind of Rocket kind of saying things over the top and almost kind of taking the mick out of him. I wouldn't rank it too highly or anything like that. It's always nice to kind of see the cameo and everything. It's always fun to kind of play the kind of guessing game of where he's going to appear and what the scene's going to be. I wouldn't say it was underwhelming or anything like that. It's just kind of a normal cameo that you could expect from the films.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it just serves more as a plot device to Rocket for us to show that this guy is just going to rip the piss out of anyone he sees. So that's how it works.
No, definitely. Let's all sort the credit scene. A character that appeared for the first time in the MCU, a character that would go on to come back in Avengers Endgame, George Lucas's beloved Howard the Duck. At the time, this was leaked for me. I remember hearing about this for a minute. I've never seen Howard the Duck. I'm going to hold my hands up and say I know his reputation, but the fact that they were going to allow this to appear as the ultimate in-game joke, I guess we can say, that does not get approved by many film studios. But James Gunn, clear into conventions, you know, just let me put this duck in the credit scene. There's nothing to lose here. And I love the fact the collector has all those weird things. We get the famous dog that was the first thing sent to space before. I love all that kind of stuff. But I can't remember the name, but the dog that he has is the dog that...
Oh, Cosmo the space dog. I've just Wikipedia'd it because I couldn't remember the name of the dog. It's a telepathic Soviet dog, is the security chief of the space station Nowhere and a member of the Guardians of the Galaxy. So, yeah. I mean, if you're going to throw any outlandish, ridiculous stuff, this is the film to do it in, right? And that's the place to do it to. But yeah, I think I was similar to you, George. I think the Howard the Duck one especially got spoilt for me before. I think I read it on an article. I knew it was coming. It wasn't until years after I realized that Seth Green is the voice of Howard the Duck, though. I didn't know that at the time, so that shocked me. And what shocked me even more was, I think it was like a still image from Endgame where you see that Howard the Duck is in that end portal's lineup of characters. So he is firmly within the MCU at this point. Whether we'll get down the line and a Howard the Duck movie, maybe in about 20 years' time when Marvel have run out of ideas of what to do with their characters, we'll get a Howard the Duck reboot.
I think we'll get him when they stop taking themselves so seriously. When they kind of, I know they're kind of planning for this next phase and they want to introduce these new characters and kind of expand the world in that way. When they're tired of expanding the world and they suddenly want to do their first spin-off film, that's when Howard the Duck will get a TV series or possibly a film.
Imagine a Disney Plus TV series on Howard the Duck. Christ.
It'd be brilliant. It'd be amazing. But it's a nice little cameo at the end, which wasn't spoiled for me. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I had absolutely no idea who this was when I first saw the film. I was like, who on earth? I actually did recognize the voice, funnily enough. I knew it was Seth Green. I just had absolutely no idea who Howard the Duck was. Then obviously you do a bit of research. I wouldn't surprise me to see it pop up in Guardians 3 or even Thor Love and Thunder at some point, to be honest. Like, those films seem quite interchangeable, don't they, at the moment? Like, you can imagine Taika and James Gunn are quite heavily involved in each other's projects, maybe. It wouldn't surprise me to see how it would be back.
That's a really cool one. I was very tempted to talk about Thor Love and Thunder, isn't it? Let's talk about Taika quickly, because jumping way far ahead, I know we should have this discussion in Endgame, that's going to be one long-ass video. What are your thoughts about the Guardians being in Thor 4? Now, I'm still devastated not getting a film called As Guardians of the Galaxy, one of the best sort of name. You know, you can imagine the poster with like an AS like put on or something as a joke, but those guys together is one of my highlights of Infinity War by a country mile. How they are, whenever the ending of Endgame, and we've got Thor going from the ship. We know that, not that we sit here researching stuff, it's been reported that they've already filmed all their scenes on Thor, Love and Thunder. We're not going to report anything else we've seen from the set, because somehow a lot of things are getting leaked, which isn't a good thing at the moment. But I am so excited just to see that. Exactly what you said. I can imagine Taika going to James Gunn, like, should we write some conversations with each other and comfortable put them into this film, because I think Taika's the kind of guy that he'd want to write some lines, but he's probably deeply respectful of James Gunn. And I can imagine them calling each other, like, look at this funny joke I've just come up with, Drake, and we can do that. And I'm excited, even if it's for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, when these guys crop up in Love and Thunder, I'm so excited.
I hate to be the party poop here. You know my thoughts on this. What I see, what Thor has become now, I'm just like, look how they massacred my boy, especially when you go back to that first Thor film. It's totally, they should be, the Guardians of the Galaxy are their own thing. Thor and Asgard and that world should be its own thing. I do like their banter, though. I guess that sort of post-Ragnarok, that was the film that completely, fundamentally changed the tone and the character of Thor beyond repair at that point. But I guess now it makes sense for them to cross over, because they have inherently became the same property, when I always think there should be a distinct difference between those two. But we know at this point, you know, if you've been following this series, that I'm not too keen on Thor Ragnarok. I don't like how they made Thor an overly comedic character in the same vein as the Guardians of the Galaxy. I think they should have been fundamentally different, but that's a different discussion for another time.
Either way, they're both cosmic characters, and I feel like that storyline heading in that way, I'm also with George. They should have called it as Guardians of the Galaxy, like, absolutely.
Oh yeah, as a title,
100%. Oh, yeah.
It's a trick, but
I don't know whether that would work better as the title for the 4-4 film, or whether that would work better as Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, because it's keeping in with what they've gone with the trend so far of kind of naming it volumes and everything like that. I think it's going to be a fun film. I think it may lean a bit more into the comedy with those interactions, and it's always nice to see different character interactions. And I love the way that Thor was able to kind of have that kind of banter, shall we say, with Star-Lord and some of the others from the Guardians of the Galaxy when they were on screen together. So I think it'll be very interesting to see kind of where it goes on from there. And yeah, I'm extremely excited to see another Guardians film. And this film was the one that set that all up.
Yeah, and I think regardless of like what we talk about comedy and that, there's no doubt that we know that James Gunn and Taika Waititi can both do like heart, and they can both do drama, Taika more than James Gunn, like, very well. So like, I think that will work. I'm just excited to see Natalie Portman kick the shit out of Chris Pratt, to be honest. I think that would be pretty cool.
Well, she's got shredded. That's one thing. That's what we have seen. She's ripped.
Death by snoo-snoo.
moving on from Thor, we'll say that we'll get to that next year. We're actually getting films coming out in the year. Can't wait. And we're not getting San Diego this year, so we wonder when that first trailer may appear. What I want to speak about, because this has been a pretty insane discussion so far, I've absolutely loved this. Can everyone let me know their favourite scene? I know we've spoke so much about the individuals, but we're not really spoken about the moments in this film. I'm going straight away with the prison breakout. That's by far my favourite moment, them coming together the first time, Batista being Batista, all of it. Beautiful scene, love it.
I'm going to have to provide two, because I'm going to sound like the worst human being possible if I tell you that my favorite scene is the opening scene. That's the one, just acting, that the kid actor as well. I don't know who he was, but my God, that moment, that's probably the moment out of most of the Marvel films in terms of emotion and drama that stayed with me the most, was that opening scene. But I'm going to offer another one, a more comedic moment. So I mean, I have kind of just mentioned it already when we talked about the soundtrack, but it's probably the opening dance scene with Chris Pratt and the title. Like, if you're going to sort of encapsulate to me what Guardians of the Galaxy is, it's that. And it's such a simple moment. It kind of plays on the tropes of like Raiders of the Lost Ark a little bit, the Indiana Jones-like character. And I think it may have been from that people were drawing that comparison. He is that treasure hunter kind of person, or artifact searcher at the beginning. But every time that comes on, it's just got the energy, it's exactly where it needs to be, and we know. And it's, I think it works because it's such a tonal shift from the scene that followed, you know, preceded it. So that's probably my favorite moment. That always gets a good laugh out of me.
For me, it's actually when Star-Lord comes out of the prison, the others are back on the ship, they're looking for the Infinity Stone in the bag, they don't see it, and they just see him gliding in with Pina Colada song playing. I think it is unbelievably iconic. I can picture it, just seeing the picture of it, I can immediately have the song playing in my head. It encapsulates the character perfectly, and it genuinely looks like it's just been ripped straight off a comic book. That is an extra large panel straight across the top. That is just a perfect comic book scene.
Yeah, I think mine's in the prison as well. I think I like the bit where they're all walking through right before we get the montage, and Rocket is telling Chris Pratt about Groot because he's like, why does this guy keep saying I am Groot over and over again? And you sort of get the beginnings of the sort of chemistry between them all. And then the montage itself with John C. Reilly over it, I think, is great. Like, there's so many sort of like highly comedic, but also just sort of, you know, like laugh. There's quite a few laugh out loud moments as well that we haven't talked about, but it's just, it just works on pretty much every level.
Yeah, it's that rewatchability, and I think we've not really spoken about in these Marvel videos, where I think this is easily, certainly up to this point of the 10, the most rewatchable Marvel film. I don't know if I'd be on my own in saying that, but in terms of you could just chuck it on at any time, I think this just about, I mean, there are, I'm going to say there are better ones out there. As much as I love the Winter Soldier, I don't think I could watch Winter Soldier 3 times in like a week, but you probably could with Guardians. And I think that all comes down to sort of, as my final thoughts as well, that comes down to the writing, the casting, the performances, the action as well. That kind of stuff is everything you want from a sort of space film. And I know it's a Marvel superhero film, and it does take into account, but you know, if I'd have seen Guardians when I was 3, this is probably my Star Wars. There's a lot of kids that these are their favorite characters. You see the merchandise, you see how much changed when Guardians came out. This is one of the biggest ones, sort of wrapping up, that it's unbelievable. And it's so much fun to re-see, because I messaged Chris, I was like, I'm kind of can't be asked to rewatch this right now because I still have the Winter Soldier in my head. But as soon as, you know, the first song kicks in, it's like, okay, I'm ready for Guardians now. And it's just, what an experience. And again, all credit to FaZe for allowing that to happen, to bring in on James Gunn and James Gunn for being the madman that executed this to perfection.
It's such a different film following on from Winter Soldier as well. Even watching the two relatively close, you know, almost back to back, could you possibly get any different? I remember thinking that as well at the time going into this film. You had the epicness that was Winter Soldier and still probably my favorite film in the MCU. And then you're following that up, that spy intrigue, realistic, it's still a comic book film, but you know what I mean? More grounded film with something that is so far away from grounded as you could get. Really quickly, another thing that feels weird watching this film again that didn't really get followed up on was the Nova Corps stuff. I don't think they feature in the second film, and then they're wiped out off screen. And for such like a crucial supporting character, John C. Reilly, Glenn Close is in this film as well. And the whole ending action scene, it felt weird to me that we never went back to that. That's not a fault of this film. That's like future MCU films. I just wanted to mention that. But yeah, no, it's a solid film. It's, you know, that classic space adventure film. It's an ensemble film that works really well. The writing's fantastic. All of the characters feel unique and different. It's probably one of the strongest ensemble films probably in recent years. And there's, you know, a reason that audiences gravitated towards it. They liked these characters. They appreciated the humor. And I think that's why it is so memorable to everyone. It was that film that was the gamble, and it paid off brilliantly. You mentioned the merchandise as well. Jesus Christ. So much merchandise came out of this film, almost centered around one character group. But I mean, you just have to look at audiences, and you have to then look at the film and go, well, what was the big audience takeaway from this? And I think it is just how strong and how visually memorable the characters are. True, the villain side of things and the story might not be as compelling, but I think it's at its core, its strengths are the actors, the casting, the humor, and those characters.
I think this is probably one of the, if not the most rewatchable Marvel films. There are better Marvel films, like we said before, like Winter Soldier, I think, is a better film. I think Infinity War is a fantastic film in itself. But this film was just so much fun. It's so bubbly. There's so much humor in there. There are heartfelt moments, and there is the context into the greater universe. But as a whole, it is a complete package, apart from the villain. And it works as just something that you can stick on the background. If you wanted to, you could watch it fully paying attention. It doesn't matter. You'll still kind of follow along with it and you'll still enjoy it. There was one thing as well that I missed about talking, which I kind of talked about beforehand with you guys just to see what your opinion was beforehand. But rewatching this film, going back and doing this kind of retrospective and everything like that, it feels so weird watching Guardians of the Galaxy and seeing regular-sized Groot and normal Groot, and then seeing the later on films and seeing baby Groot and teenage Groot. It feels like such a big kind of whiplash moment between those characters, because in this film, he is incredibly strong. You see him taking down hordes of people, very deep voice, kind of that giant lumbering character and everything like that. Whereas in the later films, he becomes, I wouldn't say a dumb but more innocent character, because he's smaller, because he's younger, because he's starting over again. But I feel like he maybe gets played a bit more for that kind of side of humor later on. Whereas in this film, he's kind of, his humor comes from the fact that he is very clumsy and everything like that. Whereas in the later films, it's because he doesn't know better.
It keeps the character fresh, I guess, doesn't it, really? It keeps the dynamic different so it doesn't get stale within films.
Yeah, and that's what you said about rewatchability as well. Like, his box office is a clear stamp of its rewatchability. People clearly went back for it to make more money than the Winter Soldier did. Like, it's just a huge gamble that paid off dramatically, isn't it?
No, absolutely. And I think that's where it comes to that. It worked with critics, it worked with fans. I think he got Oscar nominations as well. It was the perfect film. And I guess one kind of final point for me as well, for Marvel to look back and say, this worked, you know, full steam ahead. Let's get that Infinity Gauntlet. Let's get it all moving, because everyone loved our first space film. They love these guys. Now it's time for us to bring them in. Now it's time for us to bring Thanos in and start heading towards this bigger picture, which is what they were doing from the get-go. I think it's definitely something worth bringing up. I don't know if there's anything else you guys want to bring up quickly before we start to round up with the final sort of couple of social tags.
No, I think I've pretty much said everything that counts. Yeah.
Perfect. So what we want from you, we want you guys to comment below your thoughts on Guardians of the Galaxy. If you haven't already, let us know your favorite. Pick your favorite. There's one Guardian that no one's picked yet, and we'll let you guys work that out. You go back to the start of the video, because I've already forgotten. I'm not going to lie. I think it was Star-Lord. So do comment that. Obviously, of course, and if you do like this video, if you like our Marvel series, check out some of the other ones. If you're here for Guardians, hey, they crop up, so hit that subscribe button. We've got way more Guardians of the Galaxy coverage coming your way, because, you know, they've got a second film, and they end up in the Infinity War and Endgame. Do that. And if you want to find out some of our other videos, we don't just do Marvel on the channel, but we also do other Marvel stuff, which is Falcon and the Winter Soldier spoiler reviews, which are coming every Friday at 8 p.m. Obviously, we're pre-recording this. Episode 1 has not aired yet, but we want you to check that out if you do like these Marvel films. And we're going to bring up the schedule once more for you all at home. As I said, this is a pretty insane schedule. We are almost at the halfway point. That's what terrifies me, is using the word almost at the halfway point. Next up, we have what I'm very, very excited to be revisiting the first time in a long time. That is going to be Avengers Age of Ultron, coming Wednesday, the 24th of March. It's a film I have not seen in a very long time. It's a very controversial film, and it's a film that's had a lot of attention put on it recently, thanks to WandaVision. So if you like Age of Ultron, if you like WandaVision, if you like Marvel, do join us, that, because that's going to be a very interesting discussion. I think going to be a lot of different opinions in there, and I'm excited to see who we get onto that as well. So Age of Ultron coming Wednesday, the 24th of March. And if you want to get us on our social medias, our Facebook is Cinema Savvy, Twitter at Cinema_Savvy, Letterboxd.com/CinemaSavvy, and we have a TeePublic below. And Theo, I'm just bringing up your socials here. That is at TheoFisher11, if you want to talk about where we can find you.
Yeah, find me on there. Find me on at World of Real as well. Should have a Judas and the Black Messiah review coming out sometime in the next week, I think.
Absolutely perfect. So everyone do check that. We've also got a link to that in the description below. I want to thank you three for coming on Talking Guardians of Insight. This isn't our longest video by 1 minute. The Winter Soldier still has that record. And if you guys haven't seen that, check it out just for the screen that's put at the very start, because that gets its own discussion point. But that's everything from us. Thank you all for watching, and be sure to see us on the next one.